For decades, U.S. college campuses have had a tradition of fostering open debate and often being grounds for protesting injustice. But following protests of the Israel-Hamas war, student groups across the country, most notably two pro-Palestine student groups at Columbia University, were suspended. The university said the events were unauthorized and included threatening rhetoric and intimidation. It was just one of many examples of discord on college campuses as the conflict following the October 7th attack began to unfold. Professors and students alike are adjusting to the new normal surrounding freedom of speech. Let's take a look at how freedom of speech on college campuses is evolving. It seems that since freedom of speech was written into the Bill of Rights in the 18th century, how to define it and who has a right to exercise it has been a challenge. Even the federal court's webpage outlining free speech admits that the Supreme Court has struggled historically to define it. And social media has not made things any easier. College campuses, particularly public schools, sit at a unique intersection.
American universities and colleges, these are the quintessential marketplaces of ideas. This is where free speech should be the most free, at its zenith, where students and professors can have the most wide-ranging debates about the serious issues facing our society and our universities.
For college students, knowing and exercising their free speech rights can be a challenge, which is where nonpartisan nonprofit groups such as FIRE come in to try to fill in the gaps.
I'm Zach Greenberg. I am a First Amendment attorney for FIRE. We defend speech across the political spectrum, as long as it's protected by the First Amendment. If it's protected, we defend it. No excuses, no apologies.
For Zach at FIRE, that means putting landmark cases into practice, like supporting a New York area community college student following her suspension for making pro-Palestine statements during a unity gathering in support of Israel event.
Courts have made clear that public universities that are bound by the First Amendment must fully respect students' free speech rights.
Over the past century, a handful of free speech cases have helped define free speech at public schools.
Students at these universities have the same free speech rights as they would outside in society.
In the 1969 landmark ruling, Tinker v. Des Moines, the Supreme Court ruled that public school students could wear black armbands in protest of the Vietnam War, and that students do not shed their constitutional rights at the schoolhouse gate. The next year, though, tolerance and support of free speech on campuses seemed to regress when the National Guard shot and killed four students at a Vietnam War rally at Kent State on May 4, 1970. The Kent State shooting stoked greater student-led protests, and the Nixon administration assembled a task force on campus unrest, a cross-section of politicians, university presidents, and journalists. It resulted in a 400-page document that echoes many of today's persistent free speech challenges.
Speech is protected unless it falls into one of the narrow categories of unprotected speech. Among those categories are true threats, the serious intent to commit unlawful violence. And cultural genocide, that could mean a lot of different things.
A year after the Kent State protests and the campus unrest study, President Nixon lowered the voting age to 18, giving those subject to the draft voting power too. At that time, students, outraged at the limitations of their freedoms, helped to better define what freedom of speech on campus actually means for future generations.
I think students do have a voice. They should be part of the university community, and they should have a seat at the table. For example, many universities have on their board of trustees a designated student member, so students can get representation at the highest level of university leadership.
This has played out at Columbia University as well. It announced an interim policy for safe demonstrations after working with the university senate. Officials say the new policy streamlines the process to reduce the time frame necessary for approval of a demonstration. It does not, however, address the suspended student groups who continued to meet and protest. As the new policy does not reinstate the two student groups, the NYCLU and Palestine Legal announced a lawsuit against Columbia. Since then, a House committee held a roundtable with nine Jewish college students from across the country who shared their experiences with anti-Semitism on campus. Today's students face new challenges to their freedom of speech rights and are letting their concerns be known.
Students have a role to play. They might only be there for a couple of years or even shorter of that, but that's a very impactful experience for the students to be there. And as as a result, universities should acknowledge that and respect what the students have to say.